This is Walk-In's Welcome with Bridget Phetasy. I'm Bridget Phetasy, and you are welcome. You know the drill. Please subscribe, rate, comment, share, reach out, tell your friends, send smoke signals, whatever. We love your feedback and we want to hear from you.
Hey guys, Michael Malice here. Be sure to check out my weekly podcast, You're Welcome with Michael Malice, now on Podcast One. You might know me from my terrible Twitter, my horrible books, or the nonsense I spout on podcasts like Rogan and Glenn Beck. It's all there. Are you black-pilled or white-pilled for the future of the UK? What is a man?
What is a man?
What is a... No, what is the... Are you white-pilled or black-pilled? No, seriousness, girl.
No. I love the Jesse Lee piece of question.
The fact that you discovered that gives me hope for some of the things that I've still got that are missing.
Well, if you need James G. Blaine's autograph, you are welcome to it. Of course, being the co-author of How to Have Impossible Conversations makes you the perfect guest for this train wreck of a show. New episodes are available every Thursday on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Podcast One, and wherever you get your podcasts. You are welcome.
This week on the podcast, we are very excited to welcome Aida Rodriguez. Aida is a comedian, writer, and actor whose hour stand-up special Fighting Words recently premiered on HBO Max. The special concludes with a travel documentary of Aida's trips to Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic. The documentary celebrates Rodriguez's vibrant Puerto Rican and Dominican heritage as cameras capture her reuniting with her estranged father and paying it forward for up-and-coming comedians. Aida is hilarious, insightful, and she's just such an important voice in the comedy scene. I'm with Aida Rodriguez, everybody. Welcome to Walk-In's Welcome.
Oh, thank you for having me.
I'm really excited to meet you, actually, even virtually, because we have our mutual friend, Adrian Appalucci, obviously. She's a huge fan of yours.
And I am of hers. And I'm always talking about her. Every time I talk to her, I'm always bigging her up because I love her brand of humor. She makes me laugh, like, you know, she has a very, such an interesting point of view. And I think that we need all of it. We need all of it.
We do need all of it. She seems like such a comedian's comic too.
She is.
I feel like comics just love her,
mm-hmm.
which is not always great for mainstream success, but it's always great. So those are always, to me, the people who are the most fearless.
Absolutely. And a lot of times the better comedians, the most skilled, because they're being their authentic selves and not worrying about having to, you know, the conversation, well, the middle of the country, like you, it's just, it's so much work to have to think about trying to please everybody when it's impossible and it's toxic, you know, to even try to please everyone is so unhealthy for people. No, it's just unrealistic also.
Yeah. I loved how you said in your special that you were like, I used to be a political, you know, do political humor and I retired because you guys are exhausting.
Mm-hmm. I mean that.
So tell me a little bit about how long you've been in comedy, how you got into it, just a brief kind of history.
So I've been doing stand-up for 13 years now, and I started doing stand-up as a result of roasting my friend at a brunch and a comedy producer being there and telling me, Chris Spencer was like, hey, you're a comic. You should do stand-up. Here's an open mic. Go do it. And then I just started and I never stopped.
Were you in LA or New York at the time?
I was in LA.
Okay.
So, you know, Steve Hofstetter said to me, I mean, I remember just in conversation one time we were doing NACA and he was like, listen, you go on the road to get good, you go to New York to get great, and you go to LA to get famous. And so I kind of did it like, I don't know if I did it backwards or what I'm doing, but I just knew that I had to be validated in New York. So the reason I know Adrian so well is because I started coming to New York every month. You know, I had my eyes set on the Cellar, but then I started doing stand up at the Cellar and at the Stand, which I think are two of the best clubs in the country, and just really wanting to be respected and to work in New York. So I've been working in New York for the last, I would say since 2014. So the last 7 years. And that's when it really became real for me that you know, people would put me on their stages here.
I've been in New York and even just recently was at the Stand watching Adrian and Dan, and it's just different. New York comedians are different. They really just seem sharper. Something. There's just something different about it.
Yeah, you know, it's like theater here. You know, they have theater other places, but here is where people like respect it in a very different way. And in New York, people really respect comedy as an art. And, you know, when LA is very driven, comedy is driven heavily by the business part of it, the show and the business. Here is, you can feel that artsy feel because you go to a comedy club and, you know, Dave Attell is sitting there with the newest person that just got passed at the Cellar and exchanging, you know, pleasantries and dropping knowledge. And so I just think it's very different. It's just New York and the arts. There's something very pure about it here because it's so much part of the culture.
Yeah.
People have access to each other so much that they just feel a little more cultured in that way that, you know, you get on the train and there's a millionaire sitting next to a homeless person. It's very, you know, New York is a great equalizer. You have to get around and you have to be able to interact with everybody. And so art is just the epicenter of all of that stuff.
I was recently there and it does feel like it's kind of back to normal from, I think, even 4 months ago where it didn't feel quite that same way. And I think LA doesn't have that feeling quite yet. And I'm not sure if it's just because LA is so spread out, but I also think New York, I'm from the East Coast. I think there's just a general overall sense of resiliency that's baked into the culture, just a like pride in the grit that comes from being a New Yorker and just the history of that city. They've been through a lot.
Yeah, collectively too. It's just like no matter where you are, you were affected by 9/11. You know, the hurricane comes through and you're affected no matter where you live. Like it's just, I think that the healthy thing about New York is that people have to be in the presence of people who are not like them. Mm-hmm. And that gives you a different perspective and a level of tolerance that where we live in places that are so segregated and nobody is privy to the experience of another because they just don't have to be, you know?
Yeah. That's what I really love about your special. It's so different. I was watching it with my husband last night for the second time, and he was really fascinated by the documentary at the end. You know, he's like, this is so cool that she did this. And he's a therapist, so he was very into the psychology behind it and just how you were talking about how you wanted to have there be that truth in those jokes and commit to having the, it would be false if you were just making these jokes and didn't actually experience some of this. Can you talk a little bit about what inspired the documentary at the end of your special?
Absolutely. You know, I talk a lot about being Puerto Rican and Dominican, but I'm in California. I live in Los Angeles. And I just wanted to frame those jokes in a way that other people who are not Puerto Rican and Dominican could understand, because I think a lot of times we preach to the choir. We always like, it's so easy to talk to people who think just like you and talk like you. And that makes you feel grand. But the thing is, for me, is like, I really want other people to understand our experiences because I am focusing on healing. And I just think that we are so polarized and we're always talking about what makes us different. But I think if you see the family dynamic, or if you see the, you know, the way that people in the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico live, and you've never been exposed to them, then you can say, oh, those people are just like me. They just happen to be in this dialect and they're all struggling with the same things. You know, there was that. I wanted to reach back also and shine a light on newer comics in the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico. The Dominican Republic, women just started doing comedy 2 years ago.
Wow.
And it's coming up on 3. So I think that, you know, we as Americans do a lot of complaining about like all the stuff that we don't have in this country. And then when you travel outside and beyond and you learn like yeah, there are some places where stuff is good, but there are a lot of places where it's not as good. And it gives you, you know, it gives people just, it gives people perspective and groundedness that is missing. Cause you know, I mean, I'm no therapist like your husband, but I just feel like all we see is just this projection of people's pain and everything that happens, even politically. Like, you know, these people have these political arguments online and they get really like heated and deep. And you think that they're talking about, you know, talking about immigration or climate change. And they're really just talking about their father leaving them, or you know what I'm saying? It's like that's
true.
You know what I'm saying? It's like my father told me I was dumb, so now I hate immigrant Mexicans because they're gonna come take my regular job. And it's a perfect conversation to have for the public to put on the appearances that you really care about the environment, but a lot of times it really isn't about any of that. And so, you know, when I went to do this documentary, I just wanted to humanize people. I wanted to connect people. And my father is one of the most important people in my life because I'm here because of him. And everybody is so quick to just burn it down. Mm. I was like, I'm going to extend some grace to this man. And I want to see what happens from this, how I come out on the other side of this being better for it. And him too.
Yeah.
I'd like to take a quick break so we can talk about our sponsor. Well, the holidays are here, which means eating a lot, traveling a lot, and needing to look amazing while you're doing it all. That's why I can't speak highly enough about Beta Brand, my favorite pants in the world. Beta Brand's dress pant yoga pants are designed with the fit and flexibility of yoga pants, but they look like professional dress pants. I was recently traveling and I lived in my Beta Brand pants. And as somebody who is in the weird, awkward, chubby months of pregnancy, these were also the perfect pants because they're stretchy. And when I eat, they expand. And when I sit down, I don't need to unbutton them. And they travel well and don't wrinkle and look fantastic. You can throw a sweater on and be ready for a holiday dinner or an event with your family. Right now, our listeners can get 30% off their Beta Brand offers when you go to betabrand.com/Bridget. That's BETABRAND.com/Bridget for 30% off your order for a limited time. And when you use our special URL, you're supporting our show too. Find out why women are ditching typical work pants for Beta Brand's dress pant yoga pants. Go to betabrand.com/Bridget for 30% off. I was a smoker for a long time, and as much as I may have loved and enjoyed that habit, I hated myself every minute that I did it, so I could never really truly enjoy it. Smoking cessation is so important for people around you, loved ones, but mostly for yourself. Fume is the best way to quit smoking and vaping naturally. Fume is a Canadian-made, handcrafted wooden inhaler with no electronics and cores filled only with the benefits of superplants. No smoke, no vape, no nicotine. And they have a new 2021 limited edition holiday box. It's the fun, not awkward way to give a gift of quitting smoking to someone you love or to yourself. Give it to yourself. It comes with the new olive wood fume. It's unique in wood grain and a symbol of growth. And four unique to this box only cores, which I'm obsessed with: candy cane, my personal favorite, eggnog cookies, spiced orange, and snickerdoodle. So head to breathefume.com/welcome and save 10% with the code WELCOME. That's breathefume, FUM.com/welcome for 10% off on your order today.
Your kids were with you, weren't they? They're so both gorgeous, by the way.
Oh, thank you. They're so sweet.
They really are. They seem like just such sweet little souls. What was their experience of it?
You know, they were also looking at this experience. They're a little bit more removed from it, right? Because they grew up in Los Angeles, totally different experience in the Valley. And they were like, wow, this is also us. You know,
right.
Like, you know, these two kids that went to Dixie Canyon Elementary School are like, my daughter is like 8 years old begging me to make her lock us. Like, that's her experience growing up. You know what I'm saying? Growing up in LA, And then she goes to the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico and see people who look like her, but that culturally have this whole different thing going on. And I thought it was kind of cool for them to, you know, connect with that. And they did too. They were just like, wow, this is also us. Like, that's why people have to be, understand that there's so much that goes into making us who we are. And we just take for granted and like to claim these positions and these roles and these, you know, these sides. And you're not just that, you're a lot of things. And so that they were just like, wow, we really learned a lot about ourselves. It was really cool for them.
Yeah, they seemed, I think your daughter had a line that was just so perfectly cute and appropriate where she said something like, it's not me, but I can see how it also is or something. Just yeah, the way yeah, she said yeah. It was so great. It was.
There's a line that got the loudest laugh at the premiere was that line. Not into the jokes.
Because it's so just from the mouth of like a child. Yeah. And it's also so true. There's just some very deep wisdom in that statement. Where yeah. She recognizes she's not from there at all, but also senses her lineage. And
yeah,
so it was really cool. It's so cool that you shared that with your audience too. Yeah. I thought that was just so different and it added a whole other layer to your special that you don't normally see with comedians. You know, there's something about your special. I kept calling it like, I was like, I don't know if this is hilariously deep or deeply hilarious. There's just something, there was a depth with your special that I really appreciate and felt different than a lot of the specials that I've seen and a lot of the comedy that I consume. It just felt, like you said, healing. There was something about it that I felt, I kept calling it refreshing too. It was like it's a kind of tall glass of water in this like weird time we live in.
You know, I appreciate that. And I appreciate you saying that. I also was being a bit selfish in doing it because I just think that in this time where comedians, like I said, are held to a higher standard than public officials, it's like, we're like in the upside down, which I do think that words matter. And I don't think it's cool to just punch down on people and make fun of the Holocaust or, you know, like they're just things that I think that are just cheap and lowly. And I'm not going to censor anybody because I think you should deal with the consequences when you feel emboldened to say whatever you want to say. But I also think that comedians are imperfect people and people expect so much from us. And I wanted to humanize the experience so that you could see these jokes that you get to laugh at, that you just go to a comedy club and laugh at, come from a deep place and a pain of mine. And I am processing and I'm human and I'm trying my best. And So sorry that your feelings are hurt, but I am dealing with severe abandonment issues, anxiety. You know, I have my own depression that I have to visit with on a weekly basis. So sorry that in my own experience, I couldn't take the time to take care of all of you, but yeah. I am just a human being. And I wanted people to understand the process that goes into from life to the stage and how that works. And that comedians are human beings. If I was a pastor, sure. You know, if I say something that is so problematic and you need to address it, but you're not doing that. You're doing it to the comics.
Yeah. It's a weird standard we seem to be holding comedians to. And I wish we held our politicians to those same standards. It's because I always say to comedians, you know, don't necessarily die on the hill of whatever you're joking about, because that's not necessarily the argument you want to get into. And you should have to deal with consequences of whatever you say, but defend your right to be hyperbolic. You know, you're allowed to say extreme things for the sake of just saying them or getting a laugh or having that release. And comedy for me has been such a release. It saved me. I mean, it truly has saved my life. And some of the darkest times in my life, if I was not capable of having kind of an outside perspective and laughing at the absurdity of life or the situation that I found myself in, I don't think I would be sitting here talking to you.
I feel the same way. I feel exactly the same way. And you know, comedy has created a life for myself and my children that I never thought possible. But it also gave me a voice because I was also, I was a mousy kid. I was bullied. You know, I was a kid that was embarrassed to do anything. You know, like my mom would, we go to a doctor's office and she's like, can you just, can you ask them how long, much longer? And I'd be like, oh no, my God, I don't want to do that. Like I was that mousy kid and a lot of things happened to me in life. And not that I want to victimize myself because a lot of things happen to a lot of people, but I didn't have a voice. I didn't have, I didn't feel like I was heard or seen. And comedy gave me a place for that little girl to heal and, or to, you know, as I work on myself to continue to heal. But it's been something for me. And I do it because I love it and I love to make people happy.
Yeah.
It's just not about me. It's just like, I do it because I love to make people happy. And, you know, I was doing stand up and at the improv and this woman came up to me and I thought she was pretty confrontational. I thought she was coming to have, you know, tell me something about something I said. And she said, I just wanted you to know that my son hung, my 17-year-old son hung himself in my backyard 2 weeks ago. And this is the first time I've laughed since that happened. And I will love you forever, Aida Rodriguez. And she gave me a hug and started crying. And I started crying. And I was like, those are the things that I need to focus on.
Right. Yeah, because you'll hear a lot of noise, I think. And you go after, you know, certain topics and people that, and it seems like they're third rails now, although they shouldn't be. But you, I mean, one of the, I guess, examples is where you're talking about being homeless and then having somebody tell you that they're, you know, like, actually we call it unhoused, and that that whole part of your stand up. I was dying laughing because it is this weird experience of people, people putting, I see this with like the Latinx thing. They'll often do this polling where Latinos are like, please stop calling us that. And they're like, no, you're Latinx. Mm-hmm. And it seems like the same, like, I'm not sure that the homeless population really is out there caring whatever you term them. More importantly, how are we helping or making the situation worse?
No, I feel you. Look, like when it comes to identity and like, when it comes to Latinx, Latine, Latinos, Latinas, like all the people, I certainly don't have an issue with how people want to identify. What I don't want you is putting that on me and trying to force me to focus on that, because I know that a lot of times those kinds of things are smoking mirrors. Because what I care most about is the improvement of the community of my people. And so while there are a lot of Latinx people who I know who refer to themselves because they're non-binary or they're trans, and I respect that. It's all good. I will I have no issue referring to you if that's what you choose to be referred to. But I personally am going to focus on creating equity and justice in my community, because that for me is more important than that. And, you know, some people are like, you know, words matter, identity matters. Absolutely. That's your call. That's your area of concentration when it comes to the movement. And for me, it's really about how can we help a better education system for poor people in this country. We're struggling with healthcare. You know, how do we make sure that our girls are safe walking to school and not getting snatched up for human trafficking? Like those are, and boys too, because it happens to boys too. So that's just where I draw the line, because I'm not going to get railroaded into these conversations that become nothing but talking points on social media and never translate into actual actionable items for the improvement and the conditions of people. And so that's why I'm like, sure. You know, you want to talk about being unhoused? All right, let's be unhoused. What are you doing for unhoused people now that you came up with this amazing term? What are you doing for them?
Yeah, it's definitely been an area of frustration, just because it does seem like there's a lot of talk about the talk and not much action.
Absolutely. And you know, and what happens is that the powers that be, the real problem, right? The machines that are making money from the pain of the people that could care less about Black, Brown, Indigenous, trans women, like they could care less. All they are trying to do is make money. Continue, the machine keeps going. And then we're just fighting each other. We're just like destroying each other, taking each other down. And that system that's in place continues to, you know, and that's the target. The yeah. target is not like, for me, it's like, sure, I'll pull somebody to the side that says something that was disrespectful or demeaning and say, are you aware that you said that? Before I try to set them on fire on Twitter, you know, especially if it's somebody I can reach and say, hey, yeah. we need to have a conversation about this. And as a result, I would appreciate it if you did this, because I think that would be helpful to the community that you were harmful. But to burn somebody down on Twitter is just, that has to come from your own pain, you know?
Yeah. It also seems like there's an element of performativeness where it's just more for the audience and for the retweets and the kind of people siding up on either team and getting, it's all just so, the more I stumbled into the culture wars and now I'm like, how can I pivot out?
Yeah.
I really identified with you and you're like, you're exhausting. And what kind of political humor and commentary were you doing before you kind of decided that you were retiring from it?
So I go on the Young Turks a lot. I'm always on the Young Turks. I go on there and I speak. And, you know, like even with that, people will say to me, like, you know, you are on the Young Turks and you're a Young Turk and this. The Young Turks allow me to come on their platform and just be myself. Sometimes yeah. I agree with Cenk. Sometimes I don't. Sometimes I agree. We had a very big conversation on there one time about this teacher that was in Baltimore that got in trouble. And I disagreed with everybody on the panel and they didn't like castigate me for it. They were just like, that's my point of view. I'm a guest on here and they allow me to just be myself because I don't want to be anywhere where somebody is recruiting me into their talking points and recruiting me into their ideologies.
Right.
I think it's a very nuanced space where it's healthier for me in terms of politics. But I do care about the rights of Black people and Brown people in this country. And I care about the way women are treated. I also care about how children and the elderly are treated. You know, one of the biggest things that I care about is the education system, because I think that a lot of the issues that we have is because people are receiving a poor education and don't have knowledge and don't have information, because those things are power. So, you know, and talking about that stuff, it doesn't matter because you can't win for losing. And I had to reframe all of the stuff that I was doing and saying, you know, only 4% of the population of the world is on Twitter.
Yeah.
You know, 7% of the world and 4% of America. And I'm giving these people a lot of weight, you know.
Yeah.
And it was becoming so toxic, because if I would say, hey, you know, what about the rights of children, you know, and then people be like, what about the elderly? And I'm like, oh, yo, I can't. I can't win.
No, and you can't.
And it's really, you know, I'm working on jokes about it, because it's like I'm writing a whole set about why I quit, because it's just,
I can't wait.
It's just so exhausting. You know, you're fighting and they're fighting you and you're fighting for them and they're fighting you. And then they tell you, you shouldn't be fighting for them because they should have a voice. And then you move out the way and they're like, why aren't you fighting for us? And I'm like, oh, you know what? I see what's happening here. Y'all are bored.
Yeah, you need something to do.
I'd like to take a quick break so we can talk about our sponsor. As every day passes, I am more and more grateful for upgrading to my California King Helix mattress, which is not only the most comfortable mattress I've ever had, it's also big enough that it can now include the dog that occasionally sleeps in the bed, the husband, and all of the body pillows that I suddenly need to sleep comfortably as a woman with child. Helix is fantastic. You can take a quiz, find out what's best for you online. I have the Midnight Lux, which is perfect for people who sleep all over the place. It's got just the right amount of firmness. Just go to helixsleep.com/walkin, take their 2-minute quiz, and they'll match you to a customized mattress that will give you the best sleep of your life. And that is a fact. I've had mine for months now, and I'm sleeping better than I ever have. Helix is offering up to $200 off all mattress orders and 2 free pillows for our listeners at helixsleep.com/walkin. Give yourself the gift of a good night's sleep.
There is too, the just, again, back to the comedy and being able to just make these mistakes while you're trying to work through a bit or make jokes about all the things. It's weird that you're held to these crazy standards. Like you're allowed, you're somehow responsible for their feelings. I'm like, haven't you guys been in like rehab or therapy where you learn that how people feel about you is none of your business? Like this, yeah. Didn't you learn this anywhere along the way? Because you can't, as an artist, you cannot possibly be responsible for every single interpretation of your work, because it's being filtered through their biases and life experience and all of it.
And their issues. Yeah. And, you know, I also opt out of things that are not for me. I just do. Yeah. I don't make it a decision to terrorize the person because I don't like their art or I don't agree with what they're saying. I've never really thought about anybody who I totally agree with everything that they say. Yeah. I mean, I don't want to be around anybody who I totally agree with what they say and they totally agree with everything that I say. 'Cause that's a very boring existence. That means nobody is thinking for them. Somebody's not thinking for themselves and there's no critical thinking involved. I don't want to be around that. I watch some people and I'm like, even like Adrian's my friend and I love Adrian and I think Adrian is hilarious. Sometimes Adrian will post something and I'm like, ooh, that's a little bit too much for me. I can't rock with that. I'm not going to cancel Adrian. I'm not reposting this. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But
I just don't, because I know Adrian's heart and I know that what Adrian, I know who Adrian is in real life. And she's one of the most beautiful, sweet human beings on the planet. And I know that who she is on stage is her alter ego. And it is, you know, it is a reflection of thought that is necessary to be provocative and funny in comedy. And it is actually original and very different. And we need it. But I don't agree with everything, right? And we have different views about some issues that are political, and I'm not at home seething about it. Like, I can't believe that she, I'm like, whoa, her life experience is so different that this is how she sees this world, and it's not harming anybody. You know what I mean?
I saw so many, I deal with this kind of constantly, and I saw, and my friend has this ongoing joke on Twitter, and he's like, America needs a national, learn how to use the remote reckoning. Like, you know, you can just turn things off or change the channel or not engage with that person. The number of people who follow me who hate me, I'm like, why? What a waste of your life and time. I found that there are things that I've stumbled on, and it's weird when you like stumble on a caricature of your persona, like a cherry picked caricature of your persona, online persona, like out in the wild. And you'll see somebody who's reposting your likes or has a whole page devoted to whatever, like basically not liking you. And it's hundreds of hours of their time. And that's just wild to me. I've always joked, I'm like way too self-absorbed to be a stalker. Like,
man, who got time for that? You know, it also is projection, right?
Yeah.
There's something about you that ignites. And look, like I said, I'm no therapist, but I've been watching people because I will go look at a hater's page and see what they're on, right? Like, I'm like, let me see what this person's about since they figured it all out already, right? But a lot of times is that they see something in you that they hate, that they, that reminds them of something in themselves that they hate, and it's easier to deal with you with it than to face themselves and deal with that issue. And so it's easier to just target you, because I didn't follow Donald Trump on Twitter. You know why? Because it would take up too much of my day, right? Because I'm like, oh, he is provocative. He's going to say things, and you're going to, you know, you read the tweet, then you start reading the comments, and you're like, you know, 70% of Americans are idiots. They don't read books. They're on here fighting. They both wrong. This one's a liberal. This one's a progressive. That one's a conservative. They're all wrong. None of them are operating. In fact, it's all emotional. And then I'm like, and then I realize, oh shit, I've been doing this for 45 minutes and I could have been writing a joke or working on my script. But I didn't follow him because I didn't want to dedicate my time to that. I've tweeted Donald Trump before. So did everybody else. It was like America's favorite sport at one time. Yeah. But I just don't harass people who I don't like. I just disengage. I don't, if he's going to agitate me, it's going to make me angry. And then when I watched The Social Dilemma, I was like, hell no, let me go unfollow all these people. I'm playing into this. This machine is making a decision about how I'm going to spend 4 hours of my day. And 3.5 of those hours, I'm going to be angry. No more. And just so much for my life to just disengage from. I just said, you know what? I don't like frog legs. I don't want to eat them. I don't want to smell them. I'm not going to go to the restaurant that specializes in them. And I'm just going to go over here because I love shrimp. And I'm going to be at the shrimp house. And that's made my life so much easier. I'm not going to the frog leg restaurant telling the staff that frog legs are trash and that they're bullshit. And that why did the frog legs should not exist, because frog legs have triggered me because I used to play Frogger when I was. I don't do none of that. I just go to the shrimp house and I enjoy my garlic butter shrimp.
I hope you're turning this into a routine.
No, but it's made my quality of my life. So it's about quality of life.
Right. Me.
Because you know, because at the end of the day, you're a good person. And what you want to see is a better world for us all. Right.
Yeah.
That also includes you, which you should be have access to as well. Right. Because, you know, like me, am I not supposed to have a okay life because I am able to walk? That does not mean that I don't want people in wheelchairs to have a fucked up life. I want them to have a good life too. And I want to make space for them. And I want to make sure they got ramps at my comedy shows and that they can park and that they have the access that they need. But does that mean I should jump off a building because I can walk? And that is why I cannot rock with social media. That's why I can't rock with these people.
There is a kind of like crabs in a bucket feel to it, where it's just everyone trying to, it's like a small town in some ways. I come from like this small New England town, and it's very, it has that same vibe of social media where it's just people kind of trying to pull each other down so that nobody gets out.
Yeah, they all want what you got. So if you got, you know, they got 7,000 followers and you got 15,000, then maybe if they find out that, you know, when you went to prom, you know, you were going to go with an Asian guy, but then you decided to go with a white guy because the Asian guy treated you like shit and a white guy was nice to you. Now that, but if they could figure that out, oh, you know what? She hates Asian people, and she was going to go to the prom with an Asian guy, but she ended up going with a white guy because she's a racist, and nobody knows that Asian dude kicked you in your pussy and you don't know nothing about it. And he knocked you on the ground, but now you are racist because you chose to go with this white guy. Nobody knows the backstory, but because you have 15,000 followers and I only have 7, I'm going to frame this story. I'm going to go to Photo Grid and I'm going to make this thing with you, the white guy, the Asian guy, and how you were a horrible person because you left this poor Asian dude. And this Asian dude been kicking chicks in the pussy for years. You know what I'm saying? And now you are going to get taken down all because you got 15,000 followers and they got 7. And that's what I've been watching. I mean, that's been my observation. I'm like, there's a lot of that. And sure, there are some people who really care about their causes and they want to, You know what I mean? But yeah. They are the minority. They're the minority on social media.
Yeah, it's been wild. I mean, I think that was really... It was in the comedy world, and a lot of people have criticized me for being many different things, some of which I totally understand, some of which are just not, you know, one of the criticisms I'll get is like, you go on right wing media. I'm like, okay, well, I get invited on right wing media and no one on the left wing media invites me. And then I'll invite people from like very far left progressives and people onto my podcast. And they'll ignore me completely, usually, or say no, and then accuse me of only talking to people in the center or on the... I'm like, you leave me in an impossible position here. Mm-hmm. What am I supposed to do? I'll talk to anybody. I love talking to people in general.
The truth is how I feel about political parties and these ideologies is that none of them have really been good for Black people and people of color in this country, right? Mm-hmm. If we're still crying and fighting and marching for, you know, Black people not to be mistreated and murdered, and if we're still fighting for all of this stuff, then obviously a lot hasn't changed. And we're still talking about saying, you know, like you see the old white lady that was at the Women's March that had the shirt that said, I can't believe I'm still marching for this shit. You know, we're sitting around having conversations about how things haven't changed because we don't want to stare the real monster in the eye. It's so much easier to take the other people down. And for me, it's, you know, I don't have an allegiance to a political party because they don't have an allegiance to me.
None of them do.
No. And so sitting down, talking about, you know, like how problematic some of these people are, and they are hilarious to me. Like I'll watch, I'll watch Charlie Kirk sometimes and I just laugh because I'm like, you know, when Ben Glebe was on his... Ben Glebe schooled him on the whole thing about showed him the animal fetus or whatever, and then he thought he was like, that's a woman's thing, and then Ben's whole moment went viral. And I love Ben Glebe, right? Ben is my friend, and so I'm sitting there and I'm like, people are condemning Ben for having a conversation with Charlie, and I'm like, I want to condemn fucking Flint for not having good water. Like, I want to, you know what I'm saying? Like, I give a damn about who Ben is talking to. I want people in, you know, Alabama to have current school books. You know, like, that's what matters to me. And I just think we're so busy policing one another because now we have a microphone that nothing is getting resolved.
It's so much easier to do. It's just easier. It's easier to go online and be mad and be outraged and get mad at the thing that the person said or didn't say than it is to go spend those 2 hours and like volunteer in your community.
Yeah. I mean, like if you said to me, hey, would you do the podcast with me? I would love to have you, Ben Shapiro and Charlie Kirk. And I'd be like, nah, I'm good. I'm good. I'm going to be at the shrimp house. I told you I don't like frog legs, but I'm not. But if you want to have a conversation with me, I want to have as many conversations as I can with the people who I don't believe are causing harm. Right. Yeah. Because that if you and I can find something that we can do together to improve the conditions of people in this country, I want all of that. And you can't say that anymore, because now if you say that, you're not committed to the cause. What cause would you like for me to be committed to? Because tell me how that cause has benefited me and my people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I'm not with it. Like, I don't want to debate Candace Owens. I don't. I don't want to have a debate with her. I don't agree with her. I don't respect what she says sometimes, but I respect her right to say it. Keep it over there, homegirl. I'm going to be over here. I'm about to give people, you know, minority porn where they could see me going back and forth with Candace and getting into it and berating her and talking shit about her. Keep her as far away from me as possible, because we ain't trying to do the same thing, right?
But minority porn.
Yeah, I'm not doing that. Happens a lot. And then you see, well, what's it, silk and pearl or silk
diamond and silk or whatever.
What's the name of them? Yeah, the two ladies, people, you know, I would get tweeted by white people saying, this is the real people of color in this country.
And oh, geez.
First of all, I thought they were an R&B group. Second of all, I guess a damn what they have to say. And third of all, I'm not about to go back and forth with these ladies on Twitter. Like, why would I? Would I look like trying to take down these two older black women? You know what I'm saying? And just what am I going to get out of berating them and talking about their appearance? Like, go stay over there. I have no desire to get into it with anybody because it's like for like the little kids of Lord of the Flies, kill piggy. And everybody else is just watching and salivating and getting off on that. And none of us are studying the psychology about why we get so aroused at watching negativity and watching, the Hunger Games. Why are you getting joy out of this?
It's primal for sure. There's something about like, there's a fight in the quad. You know, there's that,
exactly,
that vibe on Twitter where even the other day I found myself not falling into it, but that feeling of like, there's a fight in the quad. And it was like somebody tweeted something and then someone quote tweeted them. And then this other person jumped in and I was looking at it and I was like, I hate when mom and dad fight. But there was a part of me that was like, oh, they're all going at it. There's a fight in the quad. And
yeah, I get it. I've done it. That's why I was like, I have to take like on Sunday, I'll take Twitter and Instagram off my phone.
Oh, I don't have Twitter on my phone.
Yeah, Twitter is the devil.
And Instagram, I don't really even like. So it's not Instagram for me. Is I like seeing like your posts. I like seeing Adrian's. For the most part, so many of the people I follow on Instagram are my true in real life friends.
Yeah.
And the disconnect between like the posting and their life. I'm like, I know you're not fucking live life love right now. Like you're going to burn shit down. You want to slash your ex-husband's tires and you're like, life is joy.
Like, that's exactly what it is. It's fascinating sometimes to realize that you're being entertained by it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. Okay. It's so unhealthy. And then on the other side, I love it. I've met so many amazing people. I love having conversations. I was joking yesterday. I'm like, sometimes I'm like the Ivy Getty thing, the wedding that was going viral. You know, it's those moments where I'm like, burn it all down, burn it down.
They will.
I mean, these are people who don't care, you know, that's why I fundamentally don't believe that politicians, some do, maybe they get into it caring. I don't know if they can maintain it, but people like Nancy and Gavin and all of these people who are in the pockets of billionaires, I'm like, they don't care about us.
They have so much money and they're no different than celebrities that have a lot of money. They're so disconnected. Yeah, they have no concept of what's happening in our real worlds. Like, you know, like it's so interesting to watch because Hollywood is always talking about Washington and Washington is always talking about Hollywood and they're the same people.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's just, it's all like the celebrity worship in this country has like spilled into politics.
Yeah.
And it's so gross because you can't criticize a politician because they come for you and say you're being, you know, you're hating on yourself or being a self-hating minority or you don't. And it's like, that's what we're supposed to do as Americans. We're supposed to hold these people accountable for what they're doing.
Yeah.
All of them.
I'd like to take a quick break so we can talk about our sponsor.
Honestly, I've never seen workout shorts look hot on a man. It's not the thing I think when I think workout shorts. But these 10,000 7-inch interval trainers are ridiculous. The interval shorts look super sexy on my husband. And he's obsessed with them. He loves them. They're lightweight. They're versatile. He uses them for everything from HIIT workouts on the bike, for short runs, and when he's lifting weights.
We have great features like no bounce phone pocket and permanent anti-odor treatment, but my husband is all about the lining, which he says provides a lot of support and is made with extra nice material. Quote, they don't skimp on their linings. I love this company. I love their product. If you're looking for a gift for your teenage sons, for your husband, for your brother, I think you'll love them as much as my husband does. And I do on him. 10,000 is offering our listeners 15% off your purchase. Go to 10,000.cc and enter code WIWEL to receive 15% off your purchase. That's 10,000.cc and enter code WIWEL.
Yeah, that's the problem that I have right now with the like intense hyperpolarization and the tribalism is that our team will let our people slide because they're, even if they're doing things that you might call the other team out, just because it is in this, we're all in this kind of tribal mindset. And it's like, no, burn it all down. Like they should all be held accountable. They're all in the same team. Why can't I just feel like I want to run around and be like, they're on the same team. Why can't you see this?
There's no improving us. You know, like I was talking to somebody the other day and I was like, nobody's getting on boats and going back to where they came from.
Yeah.
Like, white people not getting on. There's not going to be a mass exodus of white people that are going to go back to Europe. You know, Latinx people still trying to come here.
Yeah.
You know, people are leaving Poland coming here. People are leaving China coming here. Nobody is getting back. What are we going to do?
People still want to come here.
100%. What are we going to do? Yeah. What are we going to do? Because nobody is going to, there's no mass exodus that's happening, right? So we either going to have to, we're going to stay in a war forever, or we're going to try to figure some shit out.
I know. There's this book that I read years ago. He wrote it in the 80s, Amusing Ourselves to Death. And when you were talking about how, you know, the celebrity worship is spilled into politicians, and he writes a lot about this in this book, how essentially when education, politics, and everything else becomes entertainment, like we're fucked. and I feel like we're here.
Yeah, it is. And it's so we want to invite these politicians into, you know, our homes, and we want them to be, we want to humanize them and we want to normalize them. We're going to ground them so much that when we do that, then it's so hard, much harder for them to be held accountable. And so for me, I want to be your friend. I want to be your friend. I want to be friends with my agent. I don't want to be friends with my manager. I don't want to be friends, because I want you to do your job, because I emotionally have issues that don't allow me to stand up for myself sometimes. Mm-hmm. Because I know that about myself, I don't want to be friends with y'all. I don't want to be friends with my congressman. I don't want him to be my buddy. Oh, he's like my friend. You know what that does? It's a trap. It makes it so much harder to be like, yo, Gavin, what's up with this shit that's going on in California?
Yeah.
Because now you're like, oh, that's my friend. You know, he comes to the dinners. He hangs out. He pats the kids on the head. Nah, bro. Like, what are you doing to improve the conditions of these high tax paying people in your state? You know, and you just can't do that no more. You know, you just can't be friends with these people. They're not your favorite. They're not rock stars. They're not your favorite player. They shouldn't be.
It reminds me of like when a parent becomes their kid's friend instead of their parent. You know how bad that is for the kid. It's the reverse relationship with politicians, where it's like, no, they shouldn't. When people are like, he seems like the kind of guy I want to drink a beer with, I'm like, I don't want to drink a beer with any of these people. There's no politician that'd be like, can't wait to drink a beer with them.
I don't even drink beer.
I don't either. I'm sober.
And it's funny because it's like, if drinking a beer with this politician, we're going to conquer getting some, you know, some medication for people who can't afford diabetes medication.
Yeah, or like some freaking asthma, you know, not inhalers that aren't $500.
Yes, then we can have a beer. But if we're having a beer just so that we can kick it, I'm good. I got my own friends that I've been friends with for a long time. I don't even know you like that, bro. Like, I don't want to be friends with you.
I had the funniest conversation with a very wealthy person who's not necessarily there. It's hilarious. Like, that I have to just laugh. And they're dealing with they're used to being kind of privileged in the healthcare system. And they're dealing with a situation where they're not at the moment. They were like, I'm being treated like a grain of sand or a piece of shit. They were like, now I know how real people feel.
Oh my God.
And I was laughing so hard because I'm like, yeah, this is what us plebs have to deal with. And I was like, don't worry, the revolution's coming. And they're like, and we will rise. And my husband and I were just dying laughing. I'm like, this person's not, but they're still the 1%. You're just having this one experience where
they will get eaten because what they
I was laughing so hard, and we will rise. I'm like, you are hilarious. I can't even do anything other than laugh because it's just like you're gonna be on a private jet flying away. I always think of Tim Dillon had this hilarious during like all the protests and riots and chaos and all pandemic and a pre-election, like that crazy ass time. And he had some tweet that was like, they're out on their yachts, like, ooh, they're getting rowdy.
I love Tim. Yeah. Like,
ooh, the plebs are getting rowdy.
I love Tim.
Like, that is how it feels. It feels like from their, from their bunkers. It's definitely, I feel the hopeful thing that I'm seeing is people from like Bernie's camp, and there's kind of this cross the aisle talking occurring, particularly on podcasts, that was not really occurring, because I do think people are starting, this is a conversation I don't think like the people in charge want us to be having, but it is that populism that's existed in different kind of forms on left and right seems to be emerging a little bit more, and people are just realizing, you know, no one really has their back. And I actually think that's really healthy. I'm hopeful.
Yeah, no, this Boston Red Sox, New York Yankees mentality has to stop. Like, this whole, you know, I just think the people, I just would love if the people would just be like, what are all y'all doing? Line them all up. Line them all up. Listen, y'all want to talk about Judgment Day? Let's do Judgment Day right now. Right? Yeah. God made us in his image. Well, let's act like God. Judgment Day. What you been doing, Gavin? What's going on? Run the receipts. I mean, at this point, we need a wash.
Yeah.
That's how I'm so grossed out by what I've seen. I'm just like, and you know, the people who don't have an education and don't have the information, that they're getting all their information from cable news and they're being fed all this information. They're all revved up. They don't even know what's happening. And then these people behind the scenes are homies. They're like, did you see what I did on Fox today?
Yeah.
And then, you know what I'm saying? It's so like, I'm just like, I wish I could just show everybody, but we are so caught up, and it's just like people are making money off of those people, you know? Yep.
I remember that was really the most eye-opening thing when I first stumbled into the culture wars and I did some media hit. My cousin called me crying and was like, how could you do this media hit, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, you know what? I realized they all go to the same schools. They all have their kids having play dates. All these people from all these networks, they all hobnob behind closed doors and they're all going to parties together. And I think like when Ivanka was at Jeff Bezos's party, that was another moment where I'm like, they don't give a shit. Like, all this stuff is so fake. It's all theater.
Yeah, it is. A lot of it is. And, you know, people get caught up and they don't know because all they know is what's in front of them that's being fed to them, you know, by the machine. And so, unfortunately, they don't know that.
How do you stay grounded and sane?
I disconnect and I go within my pod of people and we watch movies, we eat, and we just disconnect because at the end of the day, that's really what matters. Like, mm-hmm. you know, when my grandmother died of cancer in 2013.
I'm sorry.
I appreciate that. And she was everything to me and was my hero. If I could, I would give everything up for her. You know, like I just, to me, it was, that was what was important, was having my grandmother. And so to me, it's like this thing that's not real. That's just this moment in time. And it's just not real. I have to stay grounded and reminded of what's important to me. And what's important to me is my family, my loved ones, and the people who show up for me. You know, it's not, you know, Hollywood or Instagram or none of that shit is real. It's all, but it's all very clever how some people really, like I have friends that are like, oh, you can't just be posting anything on your Instagram. You know, that's your brand and blah, blah. Mm-hmm. I'm like, this shit isn't real.
Yeah.
I could post whatever. I want to post a hot dog on Instagram. It's mine.
I'd like to take a quick break so we can talk about our sponsor. As we've mentioned, it's never too early to start gift shopping, especially with a gift they can use every day. Raycon wireless earbuds. I love my Raycon wireless earbuds. If you're looking for a gift to give somebody in your life, particularly the lady in your life, I highly recommend these because they have this one mode that I find extremely helpful as a woman wandering around with my dog or going for a run. It's an awareness mode which allows you to hear more of your surroundings. One of the things I really appreciate about these headphones, oftentimes I'll feel like I'm just in a bubble and it's not safe. And these allow me to feel comfortable while I'm out for my walk or run. And the sound profiles are amazing for somebody like myself who has misophonia. So you can have just the right amount of bass depending on what you're listening to, whether it's a podcast, rock, or hip hop. They have different modes for it. Go to buyraycon.com/walkins today to unlock exclusive deals up to 20% off your Raycon order. But this offer is for a limited time only and you don't want to miss it. That's buyraycon.com/walkins to unlock up to 20% off your Raycons. Buyraycon.com/walkins.
How's the reaction been to your special?
Really good. I'm very thankful. It's been positive. And, you know, it has been really positive. And I'm surprised because I thought that I was going to get a lot more heat for it. Or that people would push back on the documentary, but it's been very positive and I'm very thankful.
Yeah. But, I think
it's only been a week.
Give it time. Give it like 5 more years when you're rich and they'll be dragging stuff up from this special. Mm-hmm. I think things are changing though, too. I also, I feel like there seems energetically like there's a shift in consciousness kind of occurring. Mm-hmm. And I think it's positive. Like, yeah, I don't know. I think people like you are really helping move the needle in the direction of, like you said, healing and depth. And somebody I was podcasting with yesterday was like, you know, we all need to get off the political spectrum. Like, it doesn't matter where you are on it. We need to get off the spectrum. And I love that. But yeah, I think things like your stand-up special help elevate people off of the spectrum.
Yeah, you know, it's just like we don't do it for a living. We're not informed by it. We're not making a living off of it. So when we start talking, it's because we like innately you are like, oh, I would like to see a change in this or I want to see something better. But the reality of it is like it doesn't add anything to my life. It just takes away. It taketh away. Yeah. And that's why I'm like, you know, why am I doing this? I don't know shit. And I'm arguing with people who know less than me about shit that we not changing.
Yeah.
So we're all wasting our time.
Yep. I know you have to go. And so I'll ask the same two questions I always ask of all my guests at the end. What is your biggest defect of character?
My biggest defect of character is not being able to say no. And over booking myself. So I don't know how to say no to people. And then I overextend myself to do things that I can't do. And then I end up disappointing somebody by not showing up because I didn't say no in the first place.
Mm. And what is your biggest asset?
I think my biggest asset, which also I think sometimes serves as a defect, is empathy. I always I always see into a person to see why they're doing what they're doing. And, you know, sometimes people feel like that absolves others of their bad behaviors, but I don't know where that comes from. Sometimes it feels like a burden, because I just, you know, like my daughter will have a fight with her friend and I'll be like, well, her mother died. And she's like, but she's still a bitch. Like, why do I have to make an excuse for her? My father's not here. And I'm like, she's got a valid point. So sometimes it cripples me, but I really, really try to see into another person and their experience. And I really like to employ my empathy.
What wisdom, it seems like you've been through a lot in your life, just in overall, what wisdom do you have for people in cultivating resilience or just that attitude about life that's gotten you through?
You know, I started learning, I journal. So I started remembering really hard things in my life that seems like I couldn't get through and I'm on the other side. And so I've documented those things in a journal. So whenever something feels so overwhelming, because I mean, I've been suicidal. I don't know if I've been suicidal, but I've had suicidal thoughts. I think those are two different things. But I've been to the point where I was going to drive off a cliff with my kids because I was in such a dark place and I was like, I can't leave them. And then I was like, but I can't kill them either. Like, I've been in those dark places. And now when I'm facing something that feels really hard, I go back to those places and say, oh, I want to see that's behind me now. Mm-hmm. And so that is how I continue to build resilience is, you know, remembering the things that I have been able to overcome.
Yep.
And logging them in my book as an accomplishment.
Yep. I love that. That's really good advice. Well, I just adore you. I'm so glad I got to talk to you. I hope everybody goes and watches your special. It's on HBO Max. Just tell us where we can find you, your special on social media.
So I'm Funny AIDA on Twitter and Instagram. I'm only on there on Friday, Saturday, and a little bit of Sunday. So get your hate off during the weekend. Fighting Words is streaming now on HBO Max. I also have another Entreno special on HBO Max. And I'm also episode 3 of Tiffany Haddish's Day Ready on Netflix. So I have that as well.
Oh, cool. So you only are on social media 3 days a week?
Yeah.
That's so smart.
Yeah. I've had to make an exception the last 2 weeks because I'm
promoting.
But other than that, yeah, when this is over, and I don't know if it's ever going to be over, but I try to keep that as a practice. It keeps me
boundaries. Yep. We call it in my little community, we call it the motherfucking guardrails. I'm like, yes. You gotta put guardrails, the motherfucking guardrails.
That's right. That's right.
I hope everybody just like learns to love your comedy like I do and follows you. And I'm excited to hear about more stuff that's coming from you.
Yep. We're working on, we have a show in development on HBO Max. So hopefully we'll get that show from the page to the screen is amazing. And if not, we're going to get it on screen somewhere.
Yeah. You deserve all the things.
Thank you. So do you.
Thank you.
I'd like to take a quick break so we can talk about our sponsor. Having my own business means dealing with a lot of stuff I'm not necessarily great at dealing with. The minutiae of a business, the healthcare stuff, HR, onboarding and managing remote employees. Are you doing it all at your company? You don't need to do that anymore. JustWorks makes it easier for you to start, run, and grow a business. Let me tell you how JustWorks can help your business. With JustWorks, employees can onboard themselves in minutes with simple software that makes a great first impression. You can give them access to national large group health insurance plans and handle payroll and PTO requests all on one platform. Plus, it comes with JustWorks expert 24/7 support for you and your team. JustWorks makes it super simple to manage employees across all 50 states. Manage your remote team and run your business with confidence, which is something I don't have when I'm managing lots of people and moving parts And JustWorks gives me that confidence, an organization that is not intuitive to me. Find out how JustWorks can help your business by going to JustWorks.com. That's JustWorks.com for more info. It's time for the weekly check-in with Bridget and Cousin Maggie.
Hello, Bridget. Happy belated birthday.
Thank you. I had a grilled cheese and pickles.
For your birthday dinner? That's amazing.
Everyone's like, what are you doing on your last birthday without a child? And I'm so superstitious. I'm like, well, we'll see. I'm so superstitious. Uh-huh. Even talking about it, I get nervous, but I also can't like live in denial either.
Yeah.
My sister's like, I want to help you with your registry. I'm like, I'm not ready for this.
Yeah.
I'm not ready for any of it.
Uh-huh. It'll feel more real when you start to feel her down there.
Yeah, it's a very weird in-between time that I'm trying to be comfortable with and enjoy while also being like, is everything okay down there, baby? Hopefully it is. Hopefully.
Yeah.
It's such a weird feeling of powerlessness in your own body. Like, I have no control over what's happening.
Yeah.
And I want to control it, and I don't have any control. So all I can do is just turn it over and be in faith and try not to be in fear. But really, if I come down to, like, I can't control this, I feel calm in that.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing I can do or not do.
Absolutely nothing.
Other than, like, drink.
You worked too much on your birthday, too.
Yeah, I worked on my birthday, which I don't mind, actually. I think, too, just... it's my default, like, when I'm trying to get ahead so that we can actually take some real time off.
Right. This holiday season.
It would be nice.
Without everything grinding to a halt, actually, you know, making everything.
Yeah, we could. I mean, I think we could probably take 2 weeks off even of the podcast and it would be fine. But I just like to keep going. I think people are hanging out on the holidays and they have downtime. And why not provide some content? For our loyal and beloved listeners.
Well, we have a lot booked at this point. We've got a lot. I mean, it's gotten so busy. I just was looking at you yesterday or the other day. I mean, like, thank God I'm working full time.
I know.
I don't know what we would be doing.
Well, we wouldn't be. I would be just maintaining, which is what I was doing for a long time.
Right.
Because as you can see now how much time all this other stuff takes. When people are like, why aren't you writing? It's like, well, all this other stuff takes time.
So much time. There's just a lot of stuff we need to get kind of one and done, set in place still. But I do feel like we're making progress. Just sometimes it never feels like enough.
No. No, because you're trying to set systems in place for the business aspect of things while you're also trying to continue feeding the beast that is the algorithm.
Right. And to get like new projects up and running, which is a whole other thing.
Because I'm really not happy unless I'm starting a new project. Which reminds me, I never heard from my designer. I need to ping him.
Hmm.
Where are you? Yeah, everything's good and busy, and I'm just trying to be grateful. And the holidays are here. I love Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Really just gratitude. That is where I'm trying to stay. An attitude of gratitude. And just looking forward to even just some days off, you know, just some, like, downtime.
Yeah.
Where... I'm really looking forward to actually the holidays, which I never thought I'd see that day. But just the thought of having even like a week of just a break.
Yeah. It does. I mean, that's the thing about the holidays is there's like a collective. Everyone's taking the time off. Most people are. So everyone kind of feels like okay with it.
That was the nice thing about the pandemic.
It's true.
Everyone had to slow down. And then everybody ramped back up. I mean, we didn't really slow down even during the pandemic, but there was this collective I felt for a minute, like in the early stages of it, there was like, ah.
You baked a lot of bread.
Everybody was just kind of trying to be calm.
Mm-hmm.
But It's been very strange times. And I really have not been, I've been too busy to be on Twitter and online, which is like the best thing for me. Because when I go engage in all of it, I'm like, ugh.
Yeah, I know.
It's so unhealthy. It's just so unhealthy. Why do we do this to ourselves?
I know. It's brutal.
It is not good for mental health.
No.
Like, dumpster fire is fun because I can look at it for one day. Basically, now we're so busy. I have one day where I can, like, catch up on the news.
Right.
And figure out what I want to cover, make fun of it, and then move on. But I can't be a pundit.
Yeah. No, I loved
not like a serious one.
I loved Ida's take on it of just being like, social media is not real life. And people are like, why'd you post that on social media? It's like, this is not real life.
Yeah.
And just her whole thing about frog legs.
I know. She's
I was
so
dying.
I hope she turns that into a bit.
It really should be.
All of her perspective on it is so healthy. And there was a study that came out just this week, another one that shows like a small percentage of Twitter users put out 90% of the comment, like the top 25% users, probably of which I'm in that category.
Yeah.
And it's how few people are actually on Twitter. And it really is reflective of how it's not real life and does not necessarily represent the majority of what people in America are dealing with, thinking about, and struggling with.
And it doesn't impact most people's lives. You know, if it wasn't for you, I would have no knowledge of Twitter at all. But it does.
It's influential.
It is, I would say, overly proportionally influential on media in general. Like, so many news stories come from Twitter, which is crazy.
Well, because all the media is there.
Right.
So they're all just churning out stories. And that, yeah, it's not healthy. It's not a healthy ecosystem. Maybe the best thing that could ever happen for the world would be that Twitter would, like, go down.
I mean, I didn't realize only 4% of Americans use Twitter. That's crazy. And 7% of people worldwide.
Yeah, it's nothing. It's nothing. But it is outwardly influential on the ecosystem, particularly in media. I would say it is like a giant think tank. Mm-hmm. I've said this before. Mm-hmm. Where people from all the industries are coming together and bouncing off each other, but there's so much drama. It's so much drama, and I hate drama. Uh-huh. I like writing it and making it up, but I really do not have any. I hate it when it's like in our little Phetasy community, which happens with people, and yet whenever you have personalities in any kind of place,
right?
And it is like the as we call it, the fam. It feels like a family. So there will be things, and I'm just like, I hate this.
Right.
I grew up with it.
Right.
I just grew. I'll never forget going to your Christmas and it being so peaceful and mellow and like drama free, and you guys just read and like wrapped presents.
Sat in front of the fire.
It was very calm and quiet.
Yeah.
It was like, what is this?
Well, we should have a story hour having to do with the holidays and just like talk about
all of our holidays.
Childhood Christmases at our grandparents.
We should have a holiday edition that we put over Christmas.
Yeah, we should. I know my family still talks about that Christmas that you spent with us too. They're always like, is Bridget going to come for Christmas ever again? Because that was just like one of the best Christmases ever.
No, now I'm in the marriage and like the debate about which in-laws get you. The debate.
Yeah.
It's like, hard. Oh, yes.
It's a tough debate.
Especially when like the two of us don't want to do anything. Like, Jared and I would be perfectly happy just being in our little bubble with hope and not seeing anyone.
That's what, I mean, basically, that's what my family does. You know, we have a couple of set, you know, events that we do, but most of the time we just chill at the house. And that's why Christmases have always been so restful. And I just feel bad, especially for other people who, I think particularly when your parents are divorced or you're divorced and you're like dealing with who gets the kids.
Yeah. And if both of
you
come from children of divorce, now there's four sets of families.
Yeah.
It's craziness.
Uh-huh. And especially once you have kids, then you have the excuse to be like, we're just staying
here. Oh, no,
I
can't wait.
We don't travel for Christmas now.
My number one reason of excitement for having a child is like using it as an excuse for everything. To get out of everything I want to get out of. primarily like being able to be like, no, sorry, we're having a quiet holiday. You guys can come for dinner or whatever, but...
Oh, the baby wants to stay home for the holidays.
The child wants to stay home. I know, it's funny because I've never... It does... My sister always said that children kind of bring back the magic of Christmas. Mm. Some of us never lose it, Maggie.
I know, for years, Bridget couldn't understand why I loved Christmas.
I was like, who loves Christmas? Maggie does. But I walk by, the there's like a place that sets up to sell trees. Uh-huh. And I was like, oh, it's going to be fun to have like a kid that gets into it.
Yeah.
Because they you want to make it fun and special for them.
Their little eyes go round and they get super excited.
Yeah. They're cute. Hopefully I can get into the magic of Christmas. Uh-huh. I've done a lot of healing around the holidays.
You have a lot of work. It takes a lot of time, especially given, you know, the drama that you used to have to deal with. So
the faux Thanksgiving really helped and It was nice to just be with all the siblings in that way. And yeah, I've spent freaking thousands of dollars and years in therapy to overcome my hatred of the holidays.
Just dealing with your issues on Christmas.
Oh, it's so hard when you're a divorced kid. I feel for all the children of divorce out there these holidays. You get shuttled around. You have no power. Uh-huh. You're going from one place to another.
And you guys used to fly on like Christmas Day.
Yeah, we would like split the 2 weeks. It was nuts.
No, we got it. We definitely have to have a story hour.
It was freaking nuts. Yeah, I didn't. They weren't. And then you come home and there's like drama. It's just, it's hard.
Yeah.
Last night we were watching
Moneyball,
and there's that scene where he goes with his daughter, picks his daughter up from his ex-wife, who I only know is Jenny from
the block.
No, no, Jenny. Jenny who had AIDS.
Robin Wright Penn. Yeah. In Forrest Gump? Wow. Yeah.
That's all I know her as. Jenny who had AIDS.
She was the Princess Bride, Bridget.
I really only remember as Jenny, the drug addict.
Jenny!
So he goes to pick his daughter up from her and her new husband in their fucking sick house that's like clearly in Big Sur somewhere overlooking the ocean. And it's so awkward. And I was looking at Jared. I'm like, oh my God, please let us never get divorced. I cannot handle these like awkward interactions. And they got her cell phone and it was like a weird moment. And just, I was thinking about like meeting my dad's girlfriend for the first time and all her kids and meeting my stepdad. All of it.
That must be just terrible.
It's so hard. It's so freaking hard. I think divorces become so common, we underestimate how fucking traumatic it is. Uh-huh. It's just so common in our culture that it's like, and some people do the like divorce thing really well.
Right.
I know I had a friend who came from just like the most loving, healthy, divorced parent structure that was super supportive, and you would never have known that he was like a child of divorce.
Wow.
Because they were so great. But I think that's the rarity.
That's the rarity. Yeah.
So on that note, hope everyone has a great weekend.
We didn't quite make it to the apocalypse, but we made it to like the marital apocalypse.
Yes. If someone out there right now is like considering getting a divorce, and let me tell you, try and work it out. Tune in next week for another riveting episode that will change your life, help you get out of your own way, and solve all the world's problems. I want to thank our composer, Jared Elias, my co-producer and cousin, Maggie, and all of you out there listening. This has been Walk-In's Welcome with Bridget Phetasy. I'm Bridget Phetasy, and you're welcome. It's the dumbest line.